You're listening to In the Moment on South Dakota Public Broadcasting. I am Lori Walsh. Well, the most recent polling data for the South Dakota gubernatorial race indicates incumbent Kristi Noem has pulled ahead of challenger Jamie Smith significantly. Meanwhile, Republicans have gained more than 10,000 registered voters since the primary in June. It is the final week before Election Day, and candidates are building that enthusiasm to get people to the polls. Who shows up to vote is something that polling data can't really ever tell us. So that is part of what we're going to talk about today. We have our Dakota political junkies here for a final look at the voting season ahead of next week's Election Day. Tom Dempster is a former South Dakota State Senator, and Jonathan Ellis is with the Dakota Scout. They're both here with me in SDPB's Kirby Family Studio. Jonathan, welcome back. Thanks for being here.
Lori, I'm in a great mood today. So thanks for having me. Thanks, Tom, for being here. We've had great autumn weather. The election is less than a week away. I love it.
It's a great time of year. Tom Dempster, welcome. Thanks for being here.
I'm delighted to be here. And speaking of things I love, take a look at this.
Take a look at this. Make it's it a, rustle it, a little bit on
yeah,
the microphone.
How's that? Yeah. It's a newspaper called Dakota Scout.
Do people know about your newspaper background?
That's a long time ago. That's a long time. And I'm happy to tell the story. But, Jonathan, I just have to tell you, I cannot thank you enough for showing this community once again how critical and how important a newspaper is. You guys are so good. You guys are so thorough. You must be working 7 days a week, 24 hours a day. I don't know how you do it, but I go to your website, I go to my email, I read what you produce. I always learn something that I don't know. It's insightful, and once again, you have demonstrated the critical importance of journalism and newspaper in a community. It's invaluable. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
We're videoing this, right? I'm
yes.
blushing.
Yes. Okay. The blush is
thanks,
on our YouTube
thanks,
channel.
Appreciate it.
I mean it. It's really good.
Go to our YouTube channel later today to see Jonathan Ellis blush.
It might be a first, do you think?
Journalism is strong in South Dakota right now. I think that's fair to say.
It is.
Ellis, yeah.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, there are a lot of new outlets here that have launched, and we're trying to figure it out because, as Tom says, journalism is imperative. You know, Lori, and South Dakota Public Broadcast does its share of that, and we got to keep it going.
Yeah. All right. So let's start with something that we found in one of these vibrant news outlets. Kelland TV has the most recent poll, and it looks like Governor Kristi Noem is doing well and is pulled ahead of Jamie Smith. If you look at some of the earlier polls, it showed maybe things were a little closer, but there were a lot of undecided votes in the SDSU poll when we last talked about that. Dave Wiltsey at that time predicted many of those undecided voters would in fact fall toward the mothership, which is, the Republican Party.
Sure.
And now it kind of looks like we're seeing that happen in this current poll. Do we care about polls at all? What can polls tell us? What can polls not tell us? Jonathan, you are a polling skeptic often. I think you have a good sense, a healthy sense of skepticism about what polls can actually capture. So we'll start with you.
Polling is it's difficult to do. It's expensive to do correctly. Some of what has been released publicly, polling, I was very skeptical of that showed the race. And I've been aware of for weeks of internal polling that has been taking place that the campaigns produce. These are not necessarily publicly reported, but I get insight into what those polls say. I will say that the Kello Emerson poll is much more accurate with polling results that I've been aware of since August. So I would say that the outlier polls were the SDSU poll and some other results that we have, that were probably, the problem with polling is that a lot of bad faith actors work in that realm and then produce results that just are just not responsible.
You're not saying the SDSU poll is bad faith actors.
It wasn't. No, I'm not saying they are,
okay.
But I will
clarity,
say that
yeah.
But based on the polling results that I was aware of, it was
based on the internal polling.
Internal
compared,
polling. It was an outlier to me, and the most recent that this Emerson poll is much more consistent with polling results that I've been aware of since August.
Yeah, here we are in October, though. Tom, about this poll.
Well, bad actors notwithstanding, I mean, here's the problems that you have with a poll. I remember Nate Silver in his 538 polling when he showed a 70% chance of Hillary Clinton winning and a 30% chance of Trump winning, and then Trump wins, and then he's charged with being wrong. He says, wait a minute. He says, I'm not wrong at all. He says the 30% won. I told you he had a 30% chance. But there's all, I mean, polling is like weather forecasting. It is very sophisticated science. There's all sorts of models for it. But you've got some unique errors. If you are a Trump supporter, or if you are a rabid Trump supporter, you're not likely to pick up your phone and answer a poll. It does not, you've got your statistical error, you've got your non-response, you've got late break, and you've got turnout. You never really know what your turnout is going to be. If you have a big surge in turnout, all of your polls are going to be wrong. So it's a tool for sure, but remember, probably 3 years and 52 weeks ago, 4 weeks before the last election, Kristi Noem was 10 points behind. Mm-hmm. So it certainly can also serve to motivate and to energize, right, for sure.
And this week we have rallies, we have candidates on the road, we have that building that energy to get out the vote. How much difference does this make? And we have millions of dollars in the Noem coffers, by the way, to spend during this last week to get out that vote and to make her case. What happens in the final week? Lots of early voting has already happened, but there is a week left till Election Day. What are we looking forward to, Jonathan?
Well, I mean, that gets back to the undecideds. I mean, people who are resolute and partisan, they're the ones who I think typically will early vote, unless of course you have to take a vacation or something. But I think that the early votes are often baked into the numbers already, and it's the undecideds that how those are going to break that Tom alludes to. You know, those are the question marks. And when you have a sophisticated get out the vote operation that, frankly, the Republican Party has and has had for a couple decades at least, and the money that Kristi Noem has, you know, that's where you see a candidacy getting swamped, the opponents getting swamped in this kind of thing. So, and we talked about the voter registration numbers. You know, I have our lead story will be the voter registration numbers are actually historic. When you measure them over the decades.
Yeah, I have this here in front of me, too. I was looking at this morning. So registered voters are up just since the primary, almost 15,000 votes. 10,000 of those are Democrats. And when you look at the 2020 election...
10,000 of those are Democrats?
I'm sorry, Republicans. Thank you. Republicans. Only 531 of them are Democrats at this point. So you see a huge surge for the Republicans, not many for the Democrats at all. And since the 2020 election, you know, they're gaining now, but they had lost coming in to, coming out of the 2020 election. So they're making up that 531 is actually trying to make up ground from losses to Democratic registered voters in the state. You wanted to add?
Yeah, I was just going to say, I mean, I analyzed data going all the way back to 1970 and the voter registration numbers. The Republicans have not had this percentage of the electorate or the registered voters. They've not had this many since 1972.
Yeah. So, Tom, any thoughts on that?
That's not easy to do. That takes a lot of work, takes a lot of discipline, takes a lot of money over and over and over again.
Mm-hmm. Let's talk about the grocery tax, because that's one of the issues that has come up and has sort of been a political football, but also a little bit messy. Tom, where do you want to start?
I'll start. Can I start with Shakespeare?
Always.
Okay, always. uneasy rests the king's head. 2,500 years ago. 2,500 years ago.
Is that correct?
Yeah.
Uneasy rest the king's head, or is it uneasy rest the head that wears the crown?
Well, it's both.
Fact checking.
Yeah,
please.
It's both. Yeah. It's both.
Shakespeare.
Yeah.
Have you analyzed different translations of Shakespeare to let us know?
Oh, no. Stop it. Okay. Would you let me be? 2,500 years ago, there was a book written on statecraft. It was when the king of northern India was pulling his kingdoms together. And the name of the book is Arthashastra. And the book starts off by saying, it's a book on statecraft. It says the king, or the governor, the king is always at risk. You have sons that want your crown. You've got advisors that are going to compete with one another. You've got your enemies. You've got opponents. Everybody wants your head. And so what? You've got spies everywhere. Even, says the book, your wife may slip a cobra in your bed. And the book advises for the king or for the governor, it says, when the steam from your rice is the color of a peacock's tail, your food is poison. But it ends by saying, but by far the greatest threat to the king, or in this circumstance, by far the greatest threat to the governor, is the king himself and the policies that and the policies that they pursue, because for the king or for the governor to succeed, the state must succeed. And that's the problem that I have with this food tax. Number one, it came out of nowhere. If Governor Noem wins, I predict a very, very difficult legislative session, because you've got the self-called wackadoodles on one side that all of a sudden through the that supported the elimination of the sales tax on food. But what you've done on the Senate side is you've abandoned all of your erstwhile, all of your former friends who stood tall in order to beat the bill that turned back to eliminate the sales tax on food. So I predict, number one, in my opinion, it's very bad policy. In the Senate, we would always have a chalkboard, and on that chalkboard would be bleeders and spenders. Spenders would be new appropriation requests that are going to add more to the state budget. Bleeders would be such things as elimination of sales tax on food. This next session, conversations of $100 million bleeder. Worst case, this sets a tipping point. Probably wouldn't pass this session if it's even introduced. But 2 years from now, 4 years from now, it gains momentum. Tipping point is realized. We have a $100 million hole. Not good public policy.
Jonathan Ellis, according to this Emerson College Kello TV poll regarding the grocery sales tax in South Dakota, 47% support a full repeal, 32% support a reduction of the tax, 22% think it should stay as it is. Lawmakers during our Meet the Candidates interviews have been all over the board, frankly, and most just have a wait and see, like we need to look at the numbers before we go any further. What do you want to add to all that?
You know, Tom has lived this. I wouldn't say it came out of nowhere. I mean, voters have voted on it in 2004. They voted it down. They voted it down both in 1992 as well by tremendous margins.
Did it come out of nowhere for Governor Noem? During her campaign, she announced,
yeah, I
you know,
think
all
her,
of a sudden she's bagging groceries,
yep,
and she's saying,
for her,
I'm for this.
For
yeah.
sure, for her, it came out of nowhere. And the you know, the I want to see the, you know, she says that we have natural growth and we can get rid of this, but I would like to see the numbers, and I think everybody wants to see the numbers. You know, in this story that runs in our paper tomorrow, again, about the registration numbers, I interviewed Rick Coffey, former executive director of the Democratic Party, and he said that one of the things, and this wasn't necessarily about this issue, but it kind of casts a shadow on it. He said one of the things about the Republican Party in this state is it's been conservative, but they've always done a good job of kind of running the state ship. And a quote of his, they haven't just run it into an iceberg. And for some people, this proposal feels like running the state government, the ship, into an iceberg.
So it's a campaign promise that probably will not see resolution? Prediction? That's a big prediction.
Oh, I think she can get it done. You know, depending on how, I mean, I think she's got more support in the Senate than she had in this next legislature. I mean, I'm not saying she can't get it done. There are some Democrats how are we going to pay for this? And they would prefer to have it maybe a reduction over time versus all in one bite. But I think she's got a very good chance of getting it done.
Right. We got to leave it there for now. Next week, we'll do a recap of Election Day. Jonathan Ellis and Tom Dempster have more to say. You can find this interview on our website, on YouTube later on today. And then Dakota Political Junkies is also a podcast. So if you just want to binge on our political coverage, head there. Ellis, Dempster, sir, Senator, thank you.
Thank you.
Appreciate your time.
Thanks, Laurie.